echo 1, 2, 1. Do enjoy it.
Hey class, my name is Mrs. Aisha Ibrahim Sleman, and I'm going to be taking you Principles of Economics 2, Echo 1 to 1. And our topic for today is population. So for this lesson, we're going to discuss the definition of population, and we are also going to discuss the determinants of population size. So when we say population, population can be defined as the total number of people living within a geographical area or a country at a particular time. Population, in other words, refers to the total number of children, adults, that's men and women, youth, that's boys and girls, living in a given geographical area, which may be a town, a village, or a country at a specific time. Now, the determinants of population size. There are three main factors that determine the population size and growth of a given country. These three factors are: number one, the birth rate; number two, the death rate; and number three, we have migration. Now, the birth rate. Birth rate is the measure of total number of live births occurring among the population of a given geographical area in a specific time. Birth rate refers to the rate at which children are being given birth to in that country. What this means is the number of babies that are born alive, because you know sometimes when women give birth, the babies don't come out alive. That's stillbirth. So we're not counting those types of births. No, we're talking about babies that come out alive. That's what we count as birth rate. Generally, high birth rate may lead to increase in population, or sometimes even overpopulation, depending on the rate, depending on how much the number of births are. So if the rate is high, if the number of children that are being born is very high, sometimes it can even lead to overpopulation. While low birth rate can lead to low population. Now let's look at the factors affecting birth rate. Number one, we have early marriage. When we say early marriage, we mean marriage that involves one or both parties that are under the age. When one or both of the partners that are getting married is under the age of 18. Sometimes it's not just one of the two getting married that is under age. Sometimes the two of them. So if you have, and you can see it mainly in our communities here, a child as young as the age of 9 being married off. And this doesn't just happen to female children. Even male children, sometimes you see it. Children that are at the age of 18 getting married. This is early marriage. And so when this happens, when this early marriage occurs, their reproductive span is longer. And so they tend to have many children. They can give birth to as many children as possible. And this increases the population of that particular geographical area because you have children reproducing. So you have increase in population. Number two, desire for large family. In most communities, people tend to have many children as there is need for higher economic opportunities, or the need to reduce the risk of loss of life of their children. Also, it may arise due to status. So this is like three in one. You have 3 points in one, so I'm going to explain each one of them. When we say there is a need for higher economic opportunities. In our communities, we see what is called child labor. Children that are below the age of 18 having jobs, and the income that comes out of those jobs is mainly beneficial to the parents. The parents benefit from that. They are expecting their children to bring back something to the family. So some people have children for that reason, for them to have jobs and contribute to the family. The second one, some people have many children with the fear of their children dying. So some people feel it's better for them to have many children than to have just a small number of children and then they end up dying. But if they have many children, then at least some of them would survive. Then the third point, that status, you see rich men and kings giving birth to as many children as they can because they can afford to take care of them. They feel they can afford to take care of them. So they tend to have many children. And all these 3 points increase to population. And then number three, we have religious belief. Some religions like Christianity discourage. It is just one man, one man. Islam encourage polygamy, where a man can marry up to 4 wives. So now when you compare the two, if it's one man, one wife, the number of children they are going to have is not as high as the number of children a man with 4 wives will have. And each wife can, if you have a man with 4 wives, each of those wives can have as many children as she can. You see a man with 4 wives having 20-something, 30-something, 40-something children. So this increases the population of the region. And of course, people are giving birth, so the population is going to increase. Then government aids. Where the government increases the aids or grants it gives to people, families are encouraged to have more children, thereby increasing the population. So if you have grants and aids from the government, people have more, and so they tend to have more children. They can even get married more and then have more children. And then number six, we have improved standard of living. Improved standard of living encourages men to marry wives, thereby increasing birth rate. So if you have increased in standard of living, maybe a man that doesn't have a job gets one. Of course, he can afford to get married depending on how many wives he can have. So they tend to get married. Or if you have a wife and then your standard of living increases, you can have 2, 3, or even 4 wives. So, and each wife can have as many children as she can, so this increases population as well. So now the second factor that determines population size, like I said earlier, is the death rate. Now the death rate or mortality rate is the measure of number of people that die in a particular population or a particular geographical area. And it doesn't matter, it can be children or adults, whichever one. So if you have children dying, it also contributes to the death rate. If you have adults that are dying as well, so it doesn't matter. It could be children, it could be adults. Generally, high death rate leads to population decrease or low population, while low death rate leads to increase in population. So if you have the number of people dying higher than the number of children that are being born, then you're going to have population decrease. But when the birth rate is higher than the death rate, then you would have population increase. So if you have higher rate of deaths, it is going to reduce population. But if you have low death rate, the number of people that are dying is low, then you're going to have high population. So now let's look at the factors affecting death rate. Number one, we have ratio of male to female. When there are more males than females, there will be low childbearing rate, which will reduce population. Yes, what this means is when the number of women that are dying is more than the number of men that are dying, then you have more males than females, and thereby the childbearing is going to be low, so you have low birth rate, and then this reduces population. So if the number of women dying is higher than the number of males that are dying, then the ratio is going to be the ratio of male to female is going to be high. That what I mean here is you have more males than females, so population is going to decrease. Then number two, we have poor medical services. Like we discussed earlier in birth rate, where if you have improved medical services, you have more births and more population. Here, if you have poor medical facilities, poor healthcare, people die. People tend to die more. For example, we have diseases like HIV, malaria, tuberculosis, cholera, and so on. These diseases kill people. They kill people in high numbers. So this, if you have medical facilities, then these diseases can be treated or even prevented. But in a situation whereby the medical facilities are poor, people die of these diseases, and so it reduces the population. Then number three, we have high rate of infant mortality. High rate of infant mortality leads to decrease in population. When we say high rate of infant mortality, we mean number of children. You have high number of children that are dying. And we all know children are the leaders of tomorrow. Tomorrow means future here. So if the number of children that are dying is very high now, in the near future you have less adults because most of them are dead. So if you have a low number of adults, then those adults would bear few children. The number of births are going to be low, and so this decreases population. So if you have high mortality rate, it reduces the population. Also, like I said, death rate is, it doesn't matter whether it is adults that are dying or children that are dying. So if you have many children dying in a population, then it is reducing the number of people in that geographical area. So it is reducing the population. And then number four, we have poverty. High level of poverty among the people leads to high death rate, such as people may not have the means of taking care of their families. Poverty, if people are poor, even food becomes difficult to have, to eat. And if you can't afford the basic needs of life, it leads to death. If you can't feed, you can't shelter, you can't clothe, you can't pay your medical bills. Like I said, medical services are very important. So if you can't afford those things, people die. People tend to die, and this reduces the population of that particular area. Number five, we have natural disasters. Natural disasters occur naturally. What this means is there's no interference. It is just nature or by the will of God. Just these things happen, but it doesn't, like, there's no interference by any human or anything like that. They just occur. Like earthquakes, flood, hurricanes, and so on. They are natural phenomena. They don't require any interference of any human being. They just occur by the will of God. So when these things happen, when earthquakes, flood, hurricanes, and so on happen, they kill a lot of people. People die. And then this reduces the population of that area. Number six, we have man-made disasters. Now, these types of disasters are created by man. For example, you have war, pollutions, and so on. When people go to war, they have only one aim, to kill each other. So if people go to wars, they kill each other, people die, and as a result, reduces the population of people. Also, pollutions. Pollutions, when people contaminate environments, factories, for example, when you have factories that during their production process, they release fumes. These fumes are toxins and they poison people. Also, for example, when you look at Niger Delta areas where you have extraction of crude oil, you have oil spillage, and this oil spillage, oil spills into the water or rivers, water bodies, and also a land where people are supposed to plant their crops and food they consume, or water where you have fishes and other aquatic animals that they can consume. This oil contaminates those food sources. So that contamination also affects the people there because they can't feed, they can't eat. Also, the oil spillage also has toxins in it, and those toxins poison people and people die. So these are man-made disasters and they kill people. People die as a result of all these activities that happen, and this reduces the population of that particular area. Now, the third factor, like I said, that determines population size is migration. Migration is defined as the movement of people from one geographical area to another, involving permanent or temporary residence or settlement. In migration, the region where people are living is called the source region, while the region where people are entering is called receiving or destination region. So when people pack up their things and move from their area to a new area, then migration has occurred. Now, types of migration. We have two major types of migration. Number one, emigration with an E. Emigration. This is the type of migration in which people leave their own country. So when you leave Nigeria, we say emigration. Now, the second one is immigration with an I, immigration. This is the type of migration in which people enter into another country. So that's immigration. For example, if you leave Nigeria to Ghana, you're relocating, you've packed everything. So when you're leaving Nigeria, we say you have emigrated. And when you enter Ghana, we say you have immigrated into Ghana. So when you leave, you're emigrating. And when you enter, you're now immigrating. So, forms of migration now. Number one, we have rural to urban migration. This is the movement of people from a rural area, for example, a village, to urban centers like Kaduna, Abuja. So when you leave the village to the city, that's rural to urban migration. When we say rural, we're talking about villages or small towns, and then when we say urban, we're talking about large cities. So when rural to urban migration is when people move from the villages to the cities. Number two, we have rural to rural migration. So when people leave one village to another, when people move from one village to another, then we see rural to rural migration has occurred. Number three, we have urban to rural migrations. Migration, this is the movement of people from one urban center to a rural area. So if you leave an urban center and you move back to a rural area, then we see urban to rural migration. Number four, we have urban to urban migration. So this is the movement of people from one city to another. If you move from Kaduna to Abuja, we see what? Urban to urban migration. Then number five, we have international migration. This is the movement of people from one country to another. So like I said earlier, if you move from Nigeria to Ghana, then we say this is international migration. Then number six, we have seasonal migration. This is the movement of people from one place to another in a particular season. For example, if you go for summer holiday abroad, this is seasonal migration, because like we said, migration could be temporary or permanent. So if you just go for holiday abroad, that's seasonal migration if it is due to the weather. So if it's summertime and you go abroad for holiday, then we say it is seasonal migration. Then now, we're also going to discuss the factors affecting migration. So what are the factors that encourage migration? Number one, we have natural disasters, like I explained earlier. So if you have natural disasters like earthquake, flood, famine, drought, and so on, could make people to migrate out of a place to another. So if you have earthquakes or floods, these natural disasters, they make the places almost inhabitable. People find it difficult to live there. So people move. People leave that particular area to another for a better life. Number two, we have physical conditions. The physical conditions of a place, such as climate, soil, and so on, can also affect migration. For example, if the climate is harsh, like people living in Sahara regions, desert regions where it is very hot, or people that live in extremely cold areas, like Alaska, for example, it is extremely cold. So those climates are very harsh, and sometimes people tend to move for a more favorable environment. Soil as well. So if people are living, like I said, in these areas, plants barely grow. It is very difficult for plants to grow in some certain areas, or the soil there is not conducive for planting crops. For example, if you have sandy soil, you don't plant crops with sandy soil. It's mostly loamy soil. So if you don't have that, people tend to move to another area where they can. So that also encourages migration as well. Relief may also be responsible for the migration of people, especially when such conditions are unfavorable. Yeah, so if these conditions, living conditions of people, is very harsh, people tend to move. Number three, we have difference in economic opportunities. As a result of this, people try to migrate to where there are more economic opportunities, like jobs and business transactions. So if you're living in a particular area and you've tried and tried and tried and applied and applied and applied for a job or a particular business in that area and it is not forthcoming, people move to a different area where there are job opportunities there or there are businesses there, so people can move there in search of better economic opportunities. Number four, we have insecurity. Fear of insecurity arising from war or political instability could make people to migrate. So if a particular area has insecurity where people are killed by the day. People fear for their lives and properties, and thereby they tend to pack up and leave. They move, they migrate to another place where it is safer. Political instability as well, because you can have political crisis as a result of maybe election or clash between two political parties. People tend to lose their lives. Houses are burnt, markets are burnt, people lose their properties and their lives as well. So because as a result of that, people tend to move to a safer environment where all these things don't happen. So this is what we mean by insecurity. When people fear for their lives and properties, they leave. They tend to move to a place where they feel safe, where they feel secured, where they feel their lives and properties are going to be well taken care of. So if insecurity is also another factor that encourages migration. Then number five, we have differences in social amenities. Availability of amenities like water, roads, electricity, and so on. People tend to move to areas where these amenities are present. So, and we see this especially in urban areas. In urban areas, you have more social amenities like roads, electricity, and water compared to urban centers. Compared to rural areas. So people tend to migrate from these rural areas where these amenities are absent to urban centers where these amenities are present. And sometimes it's even within urban cities. There are some cities that have more amenities than others, so people tend to move from the areas that these amenities are absent to areas where these amenities are available to enjoy them. So this also, social amenities also encourage migration. And then the sixth one is change in status. Change in status, e.g. high level of education and wealth, could make people to migrate, especially from rural to urban centers. So if you have people living in rural areas and then they acquire education or wealth, they feel like the urban, the rural centers are now below their standard of living. And so they tend to move to urban cities where they feel they can afford the life there, and it is better for them because of their education or their wealth. So they tend to migrate from those rural areas to urban cities where they can enjoy the amenities, like I said earlier, and other opportunities that are available there that aren't available in rural areas. So I hope you've understood the lesson for today, and for our next class, we are going to discuss population census.